I'm from the UK. I'm a technical evangelist. My name's Martin Beebe. I'm on that Twitter there at the Beebs. If you're on Twitter, tweet me. We can talk about how much it sold for, which is ridiculous. Anyway, I'm going to be talking about Windows 8 applications and building them with HTML, JavaScript, and CSS. Can I get the volume just a little bit lower because I'm getting some feedback? Ah, look at the lights. They're lovely. It's like the stars. I digress. So I've been building Windows 8 applications now for about 3 years in the UK. And I work with large partners like the Financial Times, which is a big newspaper in the UK. And we kind of move them over to Windows 8 from their current platforms. I now go around the country in the UK talking about how we build Windows 8 applications using JavaScript and HTML. This is a kind of beginner, I would say, session in terms of, you know, I'm going to cover a lot of ground about how to build a basic HTML and JavaScript application. And we're going to be talking roughly around some of the new features inside of 8.1 for JavaScript developers as well. How many people are JavaScript developers in the room? Like 3 people. What did someone say about JavaScript? How dare you! It's a beautiful language. Don't let anyone tell you any differently. It really is. All the readability of assembler, all the power and performance of the web. I kid, I digress. JavaScript actually is a really powerful platform. In terms of what you can do with it, the capabilities that you can do with it now, and just the layout capabilities of HTML and CSS, I think, and if you're a XAML person or an XML person which does layouts, you probably won't agree, but I think you can do much better things with layout with HTML and CSS than you can with any XML-based markup. In fact, any layout markup in the world. It's one of the most mature kind of layout systems that we have. And so, and I think that building Windows 8 applications, or 8.1 applications, it's a beautiful little world to live in if you're just doing JavaScript and HTML. It's not as scary as maybe doing it for the web, where there are so many different browsers and so many different platforms and SDKs and different libraries. It's a far simpler proposition, in my opinion. So, I'm going to talk briefly, well, what is a HTML5 app in the context of Windows 8? And then for the next 50 minutes, we're going to be building an application. So, you would imagine a HTML and JavaScript application on Windows 8 is built using HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. But it runs natively on our platform. And that's an important part, is that there's only about 3 other people in the world that build a platform in HTML and JavaScript which is native to the platform. So Firefox OS do it, we do it, and Web OS used to do it. And it's really important, that point, that we build the JavaScript framework. Because you're able to do anything in our platform with JavaScript that you're able to do with other technologies. It's a first-class citizen on our platform. It's just as valid of building an application as C# and XAML is. And all the animations and things, they work as expected, as we expected them, as we envisioned them to do when we were building Windows 8. You can use our frameworks and libraries, which are in the box inside of Visual Studio, or you can use any other way, any other library that you want to use. If you want to use AngularJS, if you want to use Knockout, if you want to use any of these JavaScript frameworks, you absolutely can do that. In fact, anything which works in IE11 is going to work in Windows 8.1. It renders using the Trident layout engine. Now, unless you're a browser geek like me, you might not know what Trident is, but Trident is the thing that IE used to render HTML and CSS. So you're running IE11 in 8.1. In 8.0, you're running IE10. But fundamentally, it is just a browser that you're in. But we've added a few levels of security to it as well. So there are things that you cannot do with code that you just take from the web. So you can't just take some arbitrary JavaScript from the web and then exec it inside of the application, because it would be a huge, stupid thing to do. So there's levels of security that we add into it to protect our users so that they are safe and they're aware that they are using, you know, an application platform which is safe and considered. You have full access to the Windows runtime, and that's important as well, because most HTML and JavaScript devs don't get that opportunity. If you're building for the web, you either build for the web and you use, you know, the standardized communication methods to talk to the device, or you might build an application using something like PhoneGap or Apache Cordova or Trident or one of those platforms where you build with HTML and JavaScript, and then you package it up, and it actually runs as a separate application. Now, they're fine, but they only have about 90, 80% coverage of the whole API on those platforms. With HTML and JavaScript, we implemented it so you have full coverage. You know, every API which is available to C# developers is available to you as a JavaScript developer. So you can do things which are weird, like you can do unzipping of files, for example, which you wouldn't necessarily be able to do on the web. You could do things that you would expect to be able to do in applications but wouldn't ordinarily be able to do on the internet, on the web, whatever you want to call it. The other thing, it's been designed specifically around touch. It has a first-class touch metaphor. So this whole platform is built around the concept of touch, which is not necessarily true of the web today. But also, of course, you'll be able to use it with mouse and keyboard as well. And the most important thing, because why would you build an application if you can't make money from it? We deploy it via a central Windows Store, which means that you can package up your application, place it in the Windows Store, and charge people for it. And we have lots of different ways that you can charge people for it. And we are probably the most accepting of all of the different platforms. We will allow you to sell it, just, you know, I want to sell my application for $1. Or we will allow you to do freemium model. So, for example, if someone wants to buy an item or an upgrade for your application, they can do it from within in the application. And we manage all that stuff. We have an API for the store, so they can buy the application, and if they want to update or upgrade to little components, perhaps, you can sell them to them, all a sort of packaged in-app experience. And if you do that, there is a 70-30 split. So we get to keep 70%. No, we get to keep 30%, and you get to keep 70% of your hard-earned revenue. And if you make more than $25,000, then you owe me some money. No. If you make more than $25,000, then it turns into an 80-20 split, where Microsoft keep 20% and you keep 80%, which is really, really important. No other platform does that at that level. And then, if you don't want to use our platform for selling your application, as was the case with the Financial Times in the UK, you don't have to. You can put the application in there for free, and if you have an existing subscriber or an existing monetization platform, you can put that into your application and use it. Other platforms do not allow that. So we are unique in that capability. Likewise, you can use our ad SDK, so you can serve ads in your applications. And if you want to use ours, that's fine. There's that 70-30 split. Or if you want to serve ads using a completely different ad platform, and we make no money, that's fine by us as well. So whatever model or business model you have, you can bring it to Windows 8, and we don't have any exclusions in the same way as other platforms do, which is pretty cool. So one of the things when you're looking around Windows 8, how many people are Windows 8 users in the room? How many are XP users? One guy's terrified to put up his hand. Windows 7? Mac OS? Linux? Interesting. I don't know what the rest of you are using. I'm thinking, well, what other platforms? Spectrums? Amiga 500 Plus? Commodore 64, that guy. Yeah, very portable. I like strap it to my back. Anyway. When you're using Windows 8 applications, you shouldn't, as a developer, be able to distinguish between a JavaScript application and a C# application. I challenge you to distinguish between those without looking, or there is a way to find out, but without looking into the internals of the operating system, it's very hard to distinguish if it's HTML or JavaScript or C# and XAML. That's not the case on most platforms for the HTML platform. So it's quite surprising when I show first-party applications we've built at Microsoft, and see if they're built in HTML5. So the first one, Xbox Video. Do you have this service in this country? No one knows. No one uses it, clearly. So Xbox Video is a kind of online streaming. You can download videos. It works across Xbox, of course, and Windows 8. So I can play various films and so forth. All this is built in HTML and JavaScript. Xbox Games, the actual games hub on the Windows 8 platform, again, is built in HTML and JavaScript. Now, you wouldn't know it looking at it. It looks just like a C# application as well. The animations are the same. The buttons, the controls are identical. You know, and that's intentional. We wrote the controls and the animations so they would work on both platforms equally as well. The travel application, a beautiful HTML application. Using the power of HTML to let you travel the world without ever having to leave Basel. Is it Basel? Is that right, the pronunciation? Yeah. I called it Basel at the airport. I felt like an idiot. Basel. So the finance application. I'm never sure who uses a financial application on any platform, but they always have them. And it tells you stocks and shares that I don't care about. But on our platform, it's even better because it's built in HTML and JavaScript. Skype. A big surprise. People would never expect this one to be built in HTML and JavaScript, but it is. And that's my son. And he's very happy because I've just told him, that's built in JavaScript. And obviously then sport. The sport app covers all sports from, you know, proper football and to American football. It's a highly complex app. There's lots of different data feeds going into that application. It's very, very complex. And they built that using HTML and JavaScript. The news app on Windows 8 brings us news such as, you know, iPad burst into flames. And perhaps the iPad burst into flames because it realized the HTML platform on my device is not as good as the one in Windows 8. Maybe, just maybe. Unlikely. And this is the weather application. Again, another beautiful, fluid application. If you scroll around this application, the animations are wonderful. It's a fantastic application to use. We have a very different, actually, I've discovered this application in Switzerland. It's very different in the UK. When you load this, the weather application in the UK, it just says, it's raining. Get over it. No, but it's beautiful, and I love this application, the way it's designed, and you know, as the weather changes, the backgrounds change, and so forth. But again, if you use these applications, and try Windows 8 devices today if you're not a Windows 8 user, and try and determine if you can figure out the difference between HTML and JavaScript applications and C# applications. You can't. Developers can't, I can't. The only way I ever know is if I actually look in the internals and figure out, well, is it running a browser shell or not? And you can get that from the Process Explorer. Anyway, so a Windows Store application, it's built using HTML, and on the top you have your application. And then we have WinJS, which is this Windows JavaScript library. We have a HTML and CSS, how do I use this thing maybe? HTML and CSS platform, that's the Trident layer. Along this, we've got this WinRT, which is the shared API across all of our platforms. So everything which is available to WinRT for C# is available for WinRT in JavaScript. We use language projection to be able to use all of those APIs. So you can use any Windows API. The HTML and CSS sits on top of the IE rendering engine, the Trident engine. And then that, along with WinRT, sits on top of Windows. And so your application has these layers in between Windows. You'll notice there's no abstractional third-party library like PhoneGap. If you wanted to use PhoneGap, you absolutely could. There's nothing stopping you, but out of the box, this is the architecture that we use. Anything which is possible on other platforms, if you don't like this model for developing HTML and JavaScript applications, you want to use another one, you know, that's completely fine. You're completely free to use those. And if it works in a browser, it will work in our store as well. But it's just, you know, this is the default kind of way it works. So I mentioned WinJS there, so what WinJS is. Well, it's a collection of, firstly, style sheets, which style the application. There are two. Light and dark, good and evil. I'm not telling you which one. There is a core, which has some really, really useful helper classes. There's a concept called promises in Windows 8 JavaScript applications. Now, promises are never kept. No, promises are in lots of JavaScript applications. Has anyone ever used JavaScript promises in libraries before? Has anyone ever used jQuery? Then you're lying, because that's got promises built all the way through it. When you're using that fluent API, when it's like CSS, kind of dot, and then it does something else, that's fundamentally a promise. And that fluent API and the way that works is something which we've developed further. And also, there are other platforms, and I know Yahoo have a promises library as well, which is almost identical. But it's doing things in a kind of asynchronous way, using JavaScript in an asynchronous way, and keeping your code really, really nice. We have the app model, which I described. Basically, there's that kind of architecture, which is in WinJS. And there are some helper functions and structuring and scaffolding to help you build those kinds of applications. We've got data binding, so you can bind your data, your JavaScript objects, to HTML in the same way that you would use it with Knockout.js or potentially Angular.js or any of these other libraries. But we built our own as well. Excuse me. There are controls. All of the Windows controls, time pickers, date pickers, all of these things are in that library. Animations, which are crucial, because most JavaScript application platforms or which go cross-platform, they never care about the animation. It's always a thing which is forgotten. You know, between designers and developers, animations are always the things which get lost, because the designer comes out with a PSD, which is flat, and the developer scratches his head and tries to put it and get it working somehow. And there's never that, you know, that very rarely, unless you're working with a very good company, do they consider the animations and transitions of content and data as it flows on a form. Well, Windows Library, WinJS makes this very simple to do, some of these animations. And then there's a collection of, you know, utilities as well. But it's a collection of toolkits to make building Windows Store apps fast and easy. That's my marketing voice. Everything in that little side panel is generally marketing. But yeah. WinJS basics. So what we're going to do is we're going to create a file, new project. Look at this, coding no hands. Amazing, isn't it? And I'm going to do it in Visual Studio. So we go take a WinJS sample application. Use the basic application template. And it will generate as inside the Solution Explorer an application. And it's just a plain HTML document it creates called default. If I change that to a H1 and replace it with hello, Basel, and then run that. Oh my god, we've got an app. It's not very good, but it's an app nonetheless. Now, if I change this to a div and give it an ID of, say, my div, so I'm that imaginative, and then we go into the default.js, which is the JavaScript file which sits behind that default HTML page, and in the onAppActivated, or app.onActivated, we're going to just add some code to create a control, and we're going to create a control in that div. So my element equals document.getElementById. There are easier ways to get elements, but I like this because it shows it's just the web. And then we put in the name of the element, which is my div. And then we new up a control. So we go into the Windows.js library, .ui, .date picker. And then we just pass in as the constructor the HTML element where we want to construct our date picker. So now if I load this, my version 2 of my minimal viable product now has a date picker control. You know, it's the Windows date picker control. So you can create them in code behind, effectively, in JavaScript, or you can be declaratively creating these controls. So if I go into back to this div, and rather than use, I don't need an ID anymore, I use hyphen data, hyphen, that should say hyphen data, but don't worry. It still compiles, but it should say hyphen data. Hyphen data, win control. And then I choose the WinJS UI time picker. I declaratively declare that control. And now when I start up, the time picker is now in place where that div was. It's black magic. How does this work? How does it create those things? Well, it creates them rather simply. In the app on activated routine, there's this line here called args.setPromise. That's not important. What is important is winjs.ui.processAll. And that crawls through all of the HTML in your application, and it finds all of those data attributes on those divs, and it creates the control. You know, it injects JavaScript, it injects all the clever things, adds all the handlers, it adds all, it's just CSS, JavaScript, those controls. They're nothing special, they're not system-level controls, they are just HTML and JavaScript. The beauty of it is, they look like they're system-level controls because we made them, and the animations and the movements and everything which works, it works exactly the same as C++ controls in XAML look like as well. So it's, that's where that magic happens, which creates the HTML markup into real controls. So there is a few differences between the web environment. See that marketing slogan? All the advantages of HTML programming, plus the power, personality, and security of Windows. Yeah, right on. You have this styling change. You know, things are styled very differently in a Windows 8 application. It looks different. There's that whole UI thing that you need to consider when you're building a Windows 8 application in JavaScript and HTML. There's the Windows runtime access, all the power of Windows at a JavaScript developer's hands. What could possibly go wrong? I'm a JavaScript developer. I can say that. Single page apps. Most of the default templates run a single page model app, single page. So you're not going to a specific URL and going to different pages. You can do that in a Windows 8 app. But generally, you're using a single page app metaphor, and you're loading in different content on demand. And the user never leaves that default.html page. It's actually just the default HTML page is a wrapper which pulls in other pages and spits them out and clears them up. It's just this one single page you're ever on. There's never a navigate to default 2 or some other page. There's a different security context as well to consider. You can't, for example, just take HTML or JavaScript and off the wire, so off the network, and then just say, you know, document.getElementById div dot inner HTML equals, and then populate some HTML content from the web directly in there. The reason we don't allow that is because it's open to abuse. There's lots of man-in-the-middle attacks. People could inject code really simply in your applications, and we wanted to avoid that. There's a great article on MSDN called Safe JavaScript Development, and some libraries use this model, this inner HTML model, to work, and those are the libraries where we have problems with Windows 8. And they're few and far between now, but all the major ones don't have these problems, but there are, you know, small JavaScript jQuery plugins, for example, you might use, which might inject HTML directly from the wire, and you will get exceptions thrown. When you get those exceptions, you know, Google it with Bing, and you'll find the answer to your problem. Again, you're in IE11, which is interesting because most people building JavaScript HTML applications are going cross-platform. That's why they choose HTML and JavaScript. However, you know, there are lots of people building for Windows 8 in JavaScript who are not going cross-platform. And for them, it's kind of cool because you're literally developing for one SDK. And that's a complete revelation. When I only had to build a JavaScript application which ran in one type of browser, and I could know up front what that browser was, it was like... Well, it's like IE6 days, you know, which were horrible, right? But it was a nice development experience when you didn't have to test around 3,000 different browsers. Now, of course, if you want to go cross-platform with this stuff, you're going to need to test and make sure you're building to web standards. But it's important to remember you could build this stuff, you know, just with one. At least you could build this stuff and just test it in one browser and know that that's the only place it's ever going to be used. And the other thing is most web developers don't ever consider offline. Although there are web standards now which can allow you to do offline in web applications, most people don't consider that when they're building these kinds of applications. So you often get, when people very new to Windows 8 start developing applications, it all works fine on their machine. Then they try and put it in the store and they'll get bad reviews because, you know, most people, when they're using these applications, are doing so offline, are doing it without network connectivity, and you have to consider those edge cases. The good thing is, it's very difficult in a browser to sometimes, there are some good APIs for working offline, but they have their limits. This is when WinJS comes into play. It can really help you understand, well, what's the connectivity currently like? You can find out things, not just if they've got internet connection, but are they paying for that internet connection, which might be an important thing. Should I, if they're on data roaming like I am at the moment, because I'm, you know, not in the UK, should my app, the application, actually be going out to the web server and fetching new data? You know, because it's costing me, what, £10 a meg or whatever ridiculous money they want to charge me this month. So, you know, you can tell a lot about the network stack from Windows, and you have that power with JavaScript, which is really nice. So we'll do a file new hub app. So there's a number of templates in which you can choose when you're starting up, say, Visual Studio. One of the nicer ones is the hub template. And this is the template or a similar style of application that they use in that finance application or the Xbox application or the news application when it starts up. So going to Visual Studio, I use Ultimate 2013, but you can use the free 2013 Express tools, which are completely free. And for Windows 8 development, there's absolutely no difference. So I create my applications, give it a name. Basel app. I could create it in C#, but I'm not going to do that. I'm going to go into JavaScript, go to Windows Store. So I've got a grid blank. I'm going to choose the hub app. It's a three-page product for Windows Store applications. And I'm going to press OK. And it's going to create me a hub app. And it's like a default kind of template. It gives me a number of things straight out of the box. There's a CSS folder, an images folder, a JavaScript folder, a pages folder, and a strings folder. This is arbitrary. You could have any structure you wanted. But this is just what they choose. In the references, you'll see there's a reference to the Windows library for JavaScript 2. And that contains those CSS files and the JS files, which I was talking about. You can look at them. They're completely open to be used. Go into default.html, and you'll see there's a content host. This is how we do the single page app metaphor in Windows applications. And what it says is, you know, start the page, the hub page. That's the first thing it's going to load into the little frame in this single page application. So if I go to the hub page, I have some stuff. And there's a little piece of text here called Basel app. I'm going to change that to Basel information, and I'm going to press F5 on the local machine. And what will happen is the hub app, the template, and the only modification I've made is Basel information is now above this beautiful gray color. Lovely gray. It's like being in Visual Studio, isn't it? So all the, you have lots of different sections. It's just, you know, temporary data. It's just got lots of, you know, random ipsum lorem data. We can do the same thing in Blend. We can do a file new project in Blend because Blend, you know, is a tool which, you know, XAML people will be familiar with, but now has, you know, a full HTML support as well. And actually, it's very, very good when you're dealing with large, very complex HTML UIs, specifically if they are built using WinJS and the Win UI controls. So it's part of Visual Studio, and it's kind of the place where you go to build your UI for Windows 8 applications. So we're going to Blend, and we choose New Project. Windows Store application. Again, I've got the same options. Click on Hub App, give it a name. Basel information. Info. It's got a version 8.1, its language is JavaScript. Press OK. And we have the same sort of application there. What's unique about Blend is we can go into interactive mode. When we go into interactive mode, we actually can use the application as if it was running. And it actually is running. It's physically running this application. I can't click on section 1, I can't click on section 2, but I can click on section 3, and it drills into the section 3, and then I can maybe, when I'm inside section 3, I could click on one of those items. So I can click on section 3 again, and click on the item. It'll take me to the items page. So I'm navigating around this application, this hub application, which is fine. And it's pretty. It's kind of cool the way it constructs. And looking at these templates is a great way to understand how it all works and how it all fits together. You'll notice when I stop the interactive debugger, it stops at the point that I left it last, so which is good. If you want to run to that index page and then navigate and look at that, you can do that. So that's your HTML and JavaScript application. And that interactive mode is really powerful. You know, it's using your application. It's actually running in memory as you're doing it. If you've got connections to web services, they will get called, and it will populate your application. You can then just pause it, come out of interactive mode, and then you can look at the DOM tree. You can look at the CSS properties of that object. You can change them. you know, it's really good to do live editing of your application. So let's look at how we would then take that hub and customize it a little. So that gray section and that text is the first problem. So Basel info, I'm just going to go down here. I click on it, and it takes me to the HTML for it. I'm going to take Basel info. I'm going to change that to Basel information, because I'm a formal kind of guy. And then I want to change this gray, horrible image from a gray image into something which I took yesterday over at the river. So if I go to the style rules, I can search the style rules. I know this has got a CSS class of hero, so .hero. Then it shows me the CSS class. I click on that. And then on the right-hand side, there's a bunch of properties, or CSS properties. And here, you can see there is a, it says that there's a gray PNG. Well, I can change that image. I can choose another image. I've got a hero image, which I took at the river yesterday, which is great. But now you'll see that my text now doesn't sit very nicely on top of that image. So I could take that image and I could rework it and give it a darker top. But what instead I'll do is I'll add another layer to that background. And this would be a gradient. I'll move the hero image down so that the gradient is on top. So now I have a gradient background as well. And then I'll modify this gradient. I'm going to flip it around. So I want the black at the top, and I want white at the bottom. And then I want the picture to come through. So if I change the opacity, or the alpha channel of the white to 0, my picture will now come through the background. And if I change the opacity of the black to, say, 80, it'll be a little bit more of a subtle effect. And they use this effect, these gradients, these CSS3 gradients, all the way through Windows 8 applications. It's really good to give a contrast to a title, for example. Now, each of those different hubs, the hub template, has lots of different sections. So let's go and customize those sections and put some real data in that section. So I go to the live DOM, and I, like I did with the CSS thing, I can search for section, and here are all my hub sections. I'm going to select all of these and delete them. And now that leaves me with a blank application. Well, it's got one hub section, which is the first bit with the image. And I'm going to add my own hub section. So I can go to assets, and a hub section is actually a Windows control. So if I click section, go to hub section, double click on that, and it's going to add it to my application, to my hub. So I've got, you see, a section with two hub sections. Now, if I go into this hub section and I look at its properties over here, I want to change those that header value to from undefined to something. So go to the HTML attributes, and I'll change the header of the Windows app control to transport. And I'm going to make this a static header. You'll see if I'm toggling that static button, it makes it active or inactive. It just puts that little arrow there, which indicates to a user that I could interact with it. What I'll do now is just add an image to that that hub section as well. So for this image, I'm going to add a picture of the transport system here. And you'll see that that image is huge, which is not what I want. What I want is to be able to take that image and zoom in on it. And there's a new CSS property called MS content hyphen zoom. And I add a zoom thing to it, and MS scroll none, and MS content limit 100 to 600%. And I give that image a width of, say, 450 pixels. And I go to the CSS properties, and I'll do it a different way. I'll do it through the property setter now. And I want to set a property called overflow. So I can go type overflow, and it shows me the property below it. And actually, I can actually press colon, auto, and press enter, and it will actually automatically populate those properties for me. And now I've got the transport map. But because I've added those CSS properties, it's now zoomable. So I can zoom around this with pinch to zoom. And just by applying a CSS property to the element, which is really nice. So let's add something a little bit more complex, because we couldn't really put that just in the App Store. We're unlikely to make any money from a pinch-to-zoom map. I've tried. We're going to add photos of this glorious city. And we're going to use that a library, which I already have from an existing project, called Flickr Searcher. Actually written by a guy in my company called Mike Talty, really great developer. And he wrote this for a project about 7 years ago. And then I took that library, and we added a little bit of promise magic to it. We made it asynchronous. And then I can now use this as like a kind of library in my application. Interestingly, if I had written this in C Sharp, I could also take that C Sharp library, if it's a portable class library, and actually put it into my JavaScript application and call C Sharp as well. So there are people out there who build JavaScript and HTML front ends, which actually call into C Sharp in the back end, if you want to do that, and if you want to use portable class libraries. There are some limitations to doing that, but it's an interesting model, and some people like it. So I'm going to add the photo section. So I'm going to edit this in Visual Studio, because I'm kind of going to be using code now. So I'm going to exit Blend and do this in Visual Studio. So I'm going to add my JavaScript library. FlickrSearcher.js. And this is the library. It's pretty complex, but it's quite simple, actually. All it does is makes an XHR request, an AJAX request, to Flickr, and then returns me a JSON file, a JSON object. The other thing I do for WinJS is I namespace it. So I declare this in my app. So actually, now I've taken this library, and I've declared it with a namespace, Flickr Searcher, this is going to be available to me anywhere in my application. I can just call this library from my application. To do that, I actually have to include the JavaScript file in the top of my default ASPX page. And then, from Hub.js, I can start adding in the concept of this photo section. So I'm going to use a template which is just some HTML and JavaScript, just some HTML and CSS, which adds a few nice pictures to the hub menu. So the hub menu is not interactive; it's just got some static pictures. The header on this one has been set to it's not a static header. So when I click on it, it will take me to the item section. So what I'm going to do is now add that function, that search Flickr function. So search Flickr, I pass in a list view and a search term to it, and it calls this search Flickr library. It gets my results. And then when that's done, promise.done, it's going to call this function, which binds the list view control, which is on the form, with the data. So all I need to do is, over here somewhere, when my application's ready, at the bottom, I'm going to search Flickr for Basel. I'm going to pass in the list view to that function that I've just created. So I'm just going to remove all this code, which is code in the template. I'm just going to comment it out. And there's another piece of code on the unloaded function, which I'm just going to comment out as well. I don't need it for the purposes of this demonstration. So now I can run this up on my local machine. And hopefully now I should be communicating with Flickr. So I'll go to the photo section. I click on photos. It goes to Flickr. And it comes back with some ugly text. I've not really sorted out how it's going to display on the UI. So it just does a guess with what's there already, these element items. It has a guess at how it could construct the UI based upon the template which currently exists there. So let's look at item bounding. Now we've got all the data. The data is coming back. We've seen that, and the list is there. Now, how do we make that UI a little bit prettier? Well, we use a thing called item binding. Now, the code for item binding can be very complex. You can do lots of very cool things with it. But basically, to bind an image, we would use this hash data win binds equals source image URL. So this is the JavaScript object. So on that JavaScript object, which I'm going to bind, it's going to have a property called image URL. It's going to bind that to the source of this particular image. So again, this is all happening magically on that process all function. It's just magically binding this stuff up together. This one here, I've got a div, and I'm using attach the text content to the title element, which I'm going to throw at this template. And you can do very complex things, like you can even winbind CSS properties like background image. And we can even use converters. So this is a converter, which just happens to be a JavaScript function. It's really, the binding's quite robust, and you can do lots with it. And it's improved a lot in 8.1 as well. So let's have a look at this is the item template, which is in the default, the default project. I'm going to delete that. Well, I'm actually, you can see all these different things where it says this is the binding that's happening automatic there. You see I'm using a win control of winjs.binding.template at the top. So I'm just going to add my own. So this is my template. I'm going to rename it item template, which is what the you might have noticed a spelling mistake there. That's going to come back and haunt us in a moment. So I've changed the item template. I've put in my own little sort of binding HTML. I've got an inner container, and then I've got an image class. So what I'm going to do is go into the section CSS, and I'm just going to add some CSS, which is going to style those two elements in my template as well. So I've got an item container template, which makes it 250 pixels by 250 pixels. And then my item image, which is on grid row 1. And then my item title, which is on grid row 2. I'm using the Microsoft grid layout system here to just to lay out my elements on the grid. And then when I play this, what's going to happen is you're actually going to get it's beautiful. It's actually broken. This is what you'd get if there was no template, just raw JSON. And the reason it's broken is because I made a typo in the class. I need to change that to item template, not template. And I start that up, and now it should use this new item template for each individual item. Boom. So now I've got images from Flickr of Basel. Well, some of them are, some of them aren't. That's Flickr for you. But you can call, any API. You can bind it to a UI. It's really very straightforward, probably far more straightforward than I made it look. Now, what happens when we click on one of those items? I want to show a bigger image. So I'm just going to go back to this element, which at the start I uncommented a lot of things. So I'm going to put that one, item.invoked, add this handler back in. And what that's going to do is when a user clicks on an element, it's going to click this function, item.invoked. And the item.invoked is then going to do something, which is going to go and take the JavaScript object, and it's going to pass it to another page, and then navigate to that page. What I'm doing is tying up, I'm just removing some of their code and adding some of mine. But fundamentally, I'm taking the object, which they selected, and I'm passing it to the item.html page. And I'm using win.js navigation to then navigate to that page. And it will pass that object as a parameter. And then on the ready function of the item page, I can then go and pick out the item that I've passed over. Now, I don't need to resolve the item because I'm actually passing it in raw. So item options.item. And then I've got my element set to this item.title. Here. So what should happen is when I click on the element, it's going to invoke the handler, it's going to pass the object, and then the title is going to be printed and bound to my HTML control. What I want to show, obviously, is the actual image. So I'm going to add an image on this item page as well. So I'm going to switch over to item.html. I'm going to grab a go to the content section and put an image. just going to leave it blank. I'm going to give it an ID so that I can actually go and speak to it somehow from the code behind. So I'll call it Flickr image. And then in the JavaScript code behind, underneath that line where I set the title, I'm going to use a different syntax. I'm just going to say document.getElement by ID. I'm going to get that element by ID, Flickr image, dot source equals, and then I'm going to pass in what I believe is the property which is coming across, which is item.url. I think that's what the name that Flickr use in the JSON feed that they give me back, so item.url. So if I go to the photo section and I click on a photo, the photo's not showing up. What's probably happened there is that I've not used the correct property name. So what I do is I put a breakpoint in there. You can, of course, breakpoint and debug JavaScript. And you'll see URL's undefined. So if I look into the item, I'll see actually that the property's called image URL. Image URL. So now I've wired that up using debugging and a little help from the debugger. I'll restart this application. I've left the breakpoint in there, so it will break again. Click on photos, click on the section. It goes and hits that breakpoint. I'll undo that for the moment. Press play. And now we have the picture showing up as well. So as I click through these different images, it's showing me the larger picture. Which is good. I got a little bit click happy when I was recording this. But wouldn't it be cool if we could add search? Now, search has changed a lot in Windows 8.1. If you used Windows 8, you'll know that you used to click the search charm in any application, and it would you'd then be able to search your application. Sadly, turns out no one ever found the search charm in an application. So the UI designers changed that and asked all app developers now to do what they probably should have asked them to do in the first place, which is add the search bar into the application. So we're going to add a search bar into the application to our UI. Now, the place I'm going to start in this is using Blend, and it's a control. So I go to my assets inside of Blend. And I search for search. And there's, you see, a search box control, which I'm going to drop on the page. I'm going to actually drop it in the live DOM. You'll see it pop up on the top left-hand corner there. And now I'm going to just set its positioning up a little bit using CSS properties. So I'm going to say, OK, I'm going to change its grid property, so where it sits in the grid. So there's a MS grid underlying this whole application. So I'm going to put it in the third column. So it moves over into the third column. And I'm going to align it center, or end, sorry, because it's the row. And I'm going to align the row center, so it comes down into center. So now it's in the nice place, but I need to then add a little bit of a margin. So I'm going to use that syntax again. I'm going to margin colon, margin hyphen left, right, colon, 20 pixels. And it's going to add a little margin now there. Now, I could have just gone and typed that into the margin box. But it's quite nice that you can set these properties like that. I'm going to just give the search box a name, an ID, and I do that by selecting it and then just giving it an ID. And you'll see in the actual live HTML that the ID has just been added, just there, search box. So now I've got my search UI done. Now I've got to wire it up with my JavaScript application. Four lines of code. To do some wiring up, I'm going to go back into Visual Studio. And inside of section.js, so the sections piece, I'm going to, well, this is where I do the search Flickr currently. I'm going to put a variable, search box. I'm going to grab the document, .getElementID. I actually made a typo earlier. You might not have noticed, but I spelled search wrong. So I'm going to spell it wrong when I get element by ID as well. Put a win control, dot win control, so it knows it's a Windows control. And now I've got that Windows control. Now I can add, you know, I can control that control by using its property. So I'll say searchbox dot. I'm going to switch off its search history. So I don't want previous searches to appear in its search history. If you put that to false, it would show it. And then I'm going to then attach when the query, so when the user presses enter or presses the search button, on query submitted of that search box control. And I'm just going to call it an anonymous function. You might do this a little bit differently if it was a real application. And this anonymous function is just then going to do exactly what my search Flickr section did, which is going to call search Flickr. And then I'm going to pass over the first parameter, which is, well, I want everything to be, even if they're searching, I still want it to be related to Basil. Why did I say that? Basil plus, and then I'm going to pass in the event detail, so the actual thing that they searched, event object dot detail dot query text. So that's the piece of text that they added into the box, which it's passing over. And I'm going to pass over the list view. So this is going to just take that query. It's going to then bind it to the list view. And we should be, when I run this. Now, if I go into photos, I've got the search box. Click on the search box, type in church. And now it's searching church in Basel. Train. It's loading them very ugly in a way there. It's kind of slightly ugly because it's loading those off the wire, off the internet. There's lots of things that you can do to improve those kinds of things. We could add some nice CSS effects and animations to it so it doesn't load perhaps until the actual whole of the image is loaded up. But fundamentally, that's how you build a very basic HTML and JavaScript application for Basel. Next, the only other thing which I really wanted to mention was the app manifest. So this is slightly unusual and something you wouldn't have to do in a HTML and JavaScript website. But we want to, let's say we wanted to add a geolocation to our application. So rather than just searching Basel there, perhaps it could change the application if I was in Germany or France or the States, it would show me their travel information and so forth. Well, to do that, I would probably want to use the geolocator, right? So I want to use the geolocation syntax. Well, by default, if you try and use a geolocation API without making any requests, it's going to fail. What the app you do in the app manifest is you can actually set up and say, I'm going to allow geolocation in this application. I'm going to try and use it. Now, if you don't put it in the app manifest, then when you try and use it, it's going to debug and fall over. It's important when you're ever using things like geolocation, the file system, that you put it into the app manifest, and which is just a project file. It's an XML project file. And in Visual Studio, you actually have a nice GUI editor, so you can change all this stuff. And also, you put into your app manifest things like the tile that it uses when it puts on the Windows 8 start screen. And you set all kinds of different properties for your application. And all of these properties are really for the store. It's telling the store, my application is going to use geolocation, my application is going to use the file system, so that when the application is actually in the store, you know, users are upfront warned that this application is going to require geolocation. It's going to require all these various things. It also means that we can, when you're doing the store, the tile which appears in the store is also declared inside of this manifest as well. So your app manifest is really crucial for your application as well. Once you've got your application, we would right-click, build, and it will create what we call an apex file, which is just fundamentally a zip file which contains all of your application. This zip file, you then go to your dev portal, your Windows dev portal, and you would upload this to the store. And it will ask you for things like the name of the application. The name has to be unique. Not just in your market, but everywhere in the Windows Store. It's going to ask you for a description. It's going to ask you potentially for some marketing information about your application, because you're now marketing your application. It's going to ask you for the actual file, the apex file, and you're going to upload that. Important to remember that to actually become a Windows 8 application developer, we've recently announced that if you're a Windows Phone developer, then you will get Windows 8 Store developer account for free. And if you're not, if you're neither, and the other way it works the other way, if you're a Windows 8 application developer, you can be a Windows Phone developer for free as well. And I think in the UK, it's £19 now. So it was much more expensive. It's about £35. So it would be the same in this country as well. Well, they'll have it's kind of a more nominal fee. But there is a fee to pay to actually submit your application to the store. You then choose which applications, which markets you want to put your app in. There are over 200 applications where you could put it in. For the most part, that's really simple. But you have to be cognizant if you're putting it into certain countries which have strict religious views, and your application, as one of my partners was lots of women in bikinis trying to put it out to a Middle Eastern country. They got refused because we will respect the various cultures of the different countries. So it might always be better if you just select the countries that you want to publish to rather than just doing this, you know, oh, I'll go everywhere. Because then you can really consider the sort of sometimes very, very things that you wouldn't think about culturally, which sometimes crop up. So you put it in the store, you publish it. It then takes around, it will ask you for lots of different information. It takes about 5 days, I think we have a 5-day SLA, between it going into the store, some engineer in Switzerland somewhere picking it up, running on their application, they test the application, they make sure it does what you say it does, they make sure it passes our certain quality bar, and then they put it into the store. Now, I don't know what it's like in this country, but in the UK, we have a 5-day SLA, but they do it in a day. So generally, I've never had an application take longer than a day for me to submit it and to actually go live in the store. It's very, very quick. And it will then show up in the store to be purchased, you know, as you would expect in the Windows Store. And the Windows Store has been redesigned in Windows 8.1 to be a lot more user-friendly and to encourage people to search and to discover stuff. They've actually used Bing's search algorithms directly into the Windows Store now, and which make it a lot more relevant and make sure that the searching is a lot more relevant and the apps are recommended to you, which are much more relevant as well. So with that, that was a whistle-stop tour of WinJS. I'm going to be in this room again after the break talking about HTML. So not about Windows 8, but just about HTML5 in general. I hope that was useful to some in some respects, and I'll see you again next year. Thank you very much.